In this video, we introduce the cross product definition of torque. We derive a formula for the torque exerted by gravity on a rigid body, and then we apply the new formula to a short example. So by now you're probably familiar with the definition of torque as the perpendicular component of force multiplying the lever arm. And this is often written as F sine theta times R, provided I have the angle labeled like I do in this diagram. So there's the perpendicular component of the force, and I can see that that's given by an F sine theta, and we multiply by the length of the lever arm to find the magnitude of the torque exerted with respect to that rotation axis. And I'll note here that that torque exerted is clockwise. So as we get into more serious applications of torque, it's advantageous to formalize the definition of torque as a vector product called a cross product. So instead of calling the torque F perpendicular times R and then having to give its direction as clockwise or counterclockwise, we're going to give a vector definition of torque as R cross F, where R is that vector that points from the rotation axis to the point where the force is applied, and then F is the force vector applied at that point. Now the magnitude of a cross product is just given by the magnitude of the two vectors that were involved in the cross product multiplied by the sine of the angle between them. So we still get the same magnitude of the torque out of this equation, but the cross product has this extra piece of information. It actually has direction. This is torque as a vector, and the direction is given by using what's called a right-hand rule. So to figure out the direction of a cross product, you need to visualize, and I'm moving to the second diagram here, you need to visualize the tails of the two vectors located in the same place. So I shifted F over and attached the tail to the tail of R. And there's a couple ways of doing this right-hand rule. My favorite way is to put my fingers in the direction of the first vector, so that's R. Sweep your fingers out to the direction of the second vector through an angle less than 180 degrees. So that means this angle, rather than going all the way through this angle that's bigger than 180 degrees. And if you do this sweeping motion, your thumb is forced to be into the page, and that's the actual direction of the cross product. And into the page is normally given by a circle with an X in it. And that's supposed to represent the tail feathers of the vector pointing into the page. There's a second popular way to visualize a right-hand rule, and that's to put your index finger in the direction of the first vector, so that's R. Put your middle finger in the direction of the second vector, that's F. And then the orientation of your thumb will be the direction of the cross product. And again, it turns out to be into the page. So in the video clip here, I'm showing the orientation of my index finger, middle finger, and thumb. And then I rotate into the correct position for the diagram, and my thumb is forced to point into the page. Now the direction of the torque vector is really saying the same thing as before. It's clockwise torque. And you can always get the direction of the torque out of the torque vector by putting your thumb in the direction of the torque vector, and then the fingers of your right hand are going to wrap around in the direction of the actual twisting force. So it's another sort of right-hand rule. Put your thumb in the direction of the torque vector. Your fingers are curling in the direction of the twist that's being caused by that torque. Now that we have torque defined as a cross product, we can approach this task of computing the torque exerted by gravity on a rigid body. And so in this diagram, I have some rigid body that's been broken into point masses, m1, m2, m3, all the way to mn. I've also labeled the center of mass of this rigid body. And in order to define torque, you have to have a rotation axis in mind. So that's at the origin, given by this little white circle. And all my position vectors are measured relative to that rotation axis. So to find the total torque exerted by gravity on this rigid body, we just look at the torque exerted on every single point mass that makes up the rigid body. And of course, gravity is going to pull straight down on every one of these. And every one of those little weights is found by just taking the mass at that point and multiplying by g. And I'm going to put a vector hat on this to indicate that it's a vector force. It points straight down. So m1g is the force of gravity on m1, and I'll do the rest. And now I can write down the total torque exerted by gravity by expressing all these torque contributions using the cross product. So the torque exerted on M1 is given by R cross F. Again, R1 is a vector pointing from the rotation axis to the location where that force is applied. So I have R1 cross M1G plus an R2 cross M2G and so on. Now in each of these terms, the MI is just a scalar quantity. And I can attach that scalar quantity to either one of the vectors in the cross product, or I could even factor it out in front of each cross product. What I'm going to do in this case is move each of these m's next to the corresponding position vector. Now each of these is crossed into a g vector, which really means a magnitude of g and pointing straight down. And as it turns out, and we're not going to prove this in this video, the cross product is distributive. And I noticed that every single one of these is crossed into the exact same vector that's a g pointing straight down. So the sum of those cross products could be rewritten as the sum of all the mi times ri vectors crossed into this vector g pointing straight down. And if I switch to summation notation here, this may become more familiar. That expression in parentheses is the sum of all the mi ri's crossing that total vector into the vector g pointing straight down. Well, that sum is familiar. It's related to the center of mass formula. That's why I have a center of mass in my diagram. And here's just a quick reminder of that, and I'll post a link to the video where it was derived. The center of mass position vector is 1 over the total mass of the object times the sum of all the mi's times their position vector ri. So that sum in parentheses is actually the total mass multiplying the center of mass position vector. And to wrap up our derivation here, again, we're going to take that scalar, big M, and we're going to move it onto the second vector instead of the first. And I end up with the total torque exerted by gravity is the center of mass position vector crossed into mg, where m is the total mass of the rigid body. So that's an r cross f, where the force is the total mass of the body multiplied by g, in other words, the total weight of the body. And the position vector is the position of the center of mass. So in other words, the way things turned out here, if I just draw the total weight vector in there located at the center of mass, the way things turned out is the total torque exerted by gravity can be found by pretending all the mass of this rigid body is located at the center of mass. You find the weight at that point, and then you use r cross f to find the torque. And I should put a vector hat on that torque. And we've got our formula. So let's apply our new formula to a simple example. In this example, I have a rod of mass m. It has a length of l. It's hinged at one end. And I'm given the moment of inertia of a rod rotating about one end. That's 1/3 ml squared. And what I want here is the initial angular acceleration of the rod. So the way our torque formula turned out for the torque exerted by gravity, all I have to do is pretend that all the mass has been concentrated at the center of mass of the object, and then I compute the torque at that location. So I have the force of gravity exerted at the center of mass location, and that's using the total mass of the rod, so that's capital M times G. And then just by symmetry here, the center of mass of this uniform rod is located at a distance of L over 2 from the rotation axis. And I immediately have my torque, and my weight vector is perpendicular to the lever arm already, so I'm just going to write down the torque quickly here as an mg multiplied by L over 2. That's the perpendicular component of the force multiplied by the length of the lever arm. And of course, this is acting in the clockwise direction. And then I use the rotational equivalent of Newton's second law, so that's tau equals I alpha, and I'll plug in the torque, that's mg L over 2, and I'll plug in the moment of inertia, that's 1/3 ml squared. And alpha is the only unknown there. We're going to cancel an m, and we'll cancel an l. I multiply both sides by 3, and I get a 3g in the numerator on the left-hand side. Divide by l, and I get a 2l in the denominator. And I arrive at a formula for alpha. It's 3g over 2l. And the last thing I should probably do here is just check the units on this expression to make sure that it makes sense. So the units of g, that's meters per second squared. The units of L, that's meters. I end up with total units here of 1 over second squared, but radians are unitless, and I can pop those into the numerator, and I end up with units of radians per second squared, which are the proper units for angular acceleration, and we're done with the problem. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.